All right, hello everybody. Welcome to the Club 500 Meetup. I'm Peter. I'm your host, and I'm really excited to be here with you guys tonight. And I know I say that every single time, but this time I'm really excited. We have Lance Lambert with us from Fortune Magazine, and you know, I found myself writing him an email one night because I saw an article that he wrote about the housing market, and I thought it was really right on point. So I thought it would be great to bring him on and talk to us for a little bit. And when I was typing the email, he's a journalist with Fortune magazine. I found myself kind of spell checking everything, you know, a couple of times to make sure I don't get any corrections back. And but yeah, we did get Lance to come join us and to talk to us a little bit about his article. But before we get into all of that, Lance, welcome to the call.
Yeah, thanks for having me, Peter. I'm really excited.
Yeah, same here. So tell us a little bit about yourself and how you got to be with Fortune magazine and what you currently are writing about mostly.
Yeah, so I'm an editor at Fortune. You know, a big part of my week is I write a newsletter called Fortune Analytics. It goes out to about 20,000 executive CEOs. And what it is it's business trends, right? I usually do surveys of the US gin pop or of like executives and follow different topics and kind of try to tell these leaders where things are going. But outside of that, I do reporting, and a couple of the topics I've really been drawn to the past 2 years have been lumber, which really was the first of the supply chain shocks happened on the wood side, just because DIY, do-it-yourself, just came so early, right off the bat. Nobody expected that. And then also the housing market. You know, it's been wild to cover this thing from the start of COVID. You know, in April 2020, CoreLogic put out a forecast that had the housing market for the next 12 months, you know, they thought appreciation would be not even 1%. And then what we got is one of the hottest housing markets on record, or as far back as we can go on record for a short period of time. So it's been really interesting to kind of watch that. And I did cover housing in the past. I worked for News Corp's Realtor.com for a couple of years. And so it's been nice to kind of circle back and just observe this craziness.
That's really great. And you've been so immersed in it for so long that I really like to kind of hear your perspective. And I always like to hear predictions as well. And I know yours is kind of based on a lot of data and really a lot of research, and you've thrown out some really good numbers in that article as well, but we're still recording it because you never know what's going to happen. Nobody really knows what happens down the road.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah. I was just going to kind of jump in by taking a step back. And so, you know, one of the big lessons out of the 2008 crisis, which, you know, the financial crisis, Great Recession, housing bubble, and subsequent foreclosure crisis, is at least among macroeconomists, is they believe that we should have done more back then, right? Done more for the broader economy, and then done more also to protect borrowers. And this time, when, you know, the crisis did come, which it was different this time because we put ourselves into the lockdowns, which caused the initial deep contraction. And right off the bat, leaders, both parties came out and passed the CARES Act very fast, $2.2 trillion, the broadest stimulus ever passed. And it had a whole host of new programs that had never been done before. And so we also don't know what are the consequences to ending those programs too. You know, on the direct side, you have the stimulus checks, which we've kind of already worked through those. And then you have the enhanced unemployment benefits, which we've now seen lapse. And, you know, and we've also started to slow a bit as some of the stimulus has been pulled out of the economy, or less of it going in. And then on the indirect side, you have things like student loan forbearance, mortgage forbearance. And those things did not just protect borrowers. They also acted as a direct stimulus into the economy too. Mm-hmm. Because it lowered households' monthly obligations, right? And a lot of people still, you know, are still not paying their student loans and have more of that free money to spend. And the same thing with a lot of these people in forbearance. So we're seeing, we're coming out of this period where we have forbearance beginning to wind down at the end of this month, September 30th, which a lot of outlets have said September 31st. And it's like, hold up, September's just, it's one of those months that's just 30 days. I've been seeing a lot of that. And so we're going into this wind down. You know, we're at, I think it's 1.5 million still in. But it's worth noting that we've dropped down from the peak of 7.2 million to 1.5. And we've dropped down without any type of housing crash. In fact, during that period is when, you know, the housing market was at its tightest on record. You know, as far back as we can go in the data is like 40 years, and it's the tightest there. And we have a country of 100 million more people. So it's pretty darn tight. But what is interesting is that some of the dynamics have changed a little bit. You know, between April 2020 to April 2021, inventory fell 53% on realtor.com. And in recent months, it's starting to go up again, right?
There's a few different forces that are kind of pushing that here between COVID, between demographics.
And exactly. So seasonality is starting to come back into the market, notably absent in 2020. People weren't taking summer vacations. Back to school was kind of deflated because so many kids were remote. So seasonality is coming back. You know, John Burns, the researchers over there told me last month, also a piece of it is some buyer fatigue. You know, some buyers just got burned out of the bidding wars and stuff. But that's not to say that they won't come back in force pretty soon, or that the spring market next year won't be insane. And so what Zillow's estimating is that of the 1.5 million, 25% of those, which is the same rate of the people who've already dropped out, 25% of those would put their homes up on the market. And so of the 1.5 million, it's like 450,000 are coming now. And then we have another 200,000, and then it's like 100,000. So the immediate impact of it is going to happen now, right? And Zillow saying, so 25%, that would be 200,000 homes.
And that's 100% based on the fact that we've already gone from 7.2 million down to 1.5 million. So we have a little bit of a rearview mirror where we can see that out of that number of borrowers, only 25% ended up listing their property on the market.
That's exactly right. So Zillow is just taking that 25% number from there, estimating to now. So if that's right, and we get 200,000 more homes, and you add that to our 1.3 million, that's still a pretty tight housing market.
1.3 million is the current number of homes that are on the market in the US in general.
Yeah, it's a little under that, but yeah. Okay. For the last month, unless it's already tighter for September. We don't have the September number right now. But the Zillow economist, I had one on the phone last week, and he was saying that would just be, it would be a market change, but it wouldn't be, you know, this dramatic shift in the market. But now let's say they're wrong. Let's say it's 50%, right? Because we don't know the household strengths of the 1.5 million remaining. It could be that these weren't the voluntary ones who left and that they could be in a worse position. So it could be higher. It could be lower too. They could have been smart and been like, well, I'm just not going to pay this and have it added on to the end of my mortgage.
Sure. It turns out to be a good decision for an investor to do that, because for us, I mean, if I get a 200 year loan, I probably would. I mean, it's really good news for the cash flow, and depending on what your strategy is, it might be a good strategy for someone. But the other thing that's very interesting about it is that we are nowhere near the situation that we were in back in 2008. And I was surprised by the number of folks that I saw, even some big names in real estate, talking about this, you know, big foreclosure crisis coming. And I was on that train as well, because I can only see what the big guys are saying and kind of go off of that. But we're not in the same position, and we're not likely to have a big foreclosure crisis, right?
Yeah, that's right. And a lot of that just comes to supply, right? So you go back and you look at 2008, and if you go right now and you just type in housing starts Fred, and you look at the chart, you'll see that amid that housing frenzy, it was also happening on the construction side, and so much supply was getting pumped in that when the market hit its brakes, we went to oversupplied very fast, mm-hmm. right? It's just so tight now. And when you match that up with demographics, it would just be hard to get into that situation. And then you also look at, when you look at cost, forget about price tag, look at cost. Mm-hmm. People's budget going to housing is lower now than it was then. Actually, a decent amount lower. And a lot of that now has been because of lowered interest rates, which has obviously been boosted prices, but has not necessarily seen the impact of that to household.
And probably one of the other main reasons why we're not going to see a big foreclosure crisis is because today people have a lot more equity in their homes because of that appreciation than they had back in 08, right?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, people have positive equity because of this housing boom. I mean, it's possible that somebody could have bought a home, and I don't know some of the ins and outs with the forbearance, but I'm just going to throw this out as a possibility. They could have possibly bought a home early 2020, made no payments almost, got into forbearance, mm-hmm. and made out like a bandit. Possibly, because that's what the change with the forbearance program was during COVID, is that you didn't have to show the hardship. That was the big change, and that's how we got up to 7.2 million. But it'll be interesting to see how this all shakes out. But the thing that I'm the most interested in is, what does the spring market look like next year? Do we go back into the frenzy that we just experienced? Or is it a little, hopefully for buyers, it's a little more mild, right? You have some of the seasonality coming back. Some of the people who've been on the sidelines, not wanting to sell, maybe they feel a little more safe because of both the vaccine. And then also, a little more inventory means they might have a little more options when they do sell. But then again, and I'm talking in circles now, if they do list, then they become one more buyer out there too. So it's not,
Yeah, exactly. It goes both ways. And I've heard people say, I really want to cash in on my equity here. I really want to cash in on the fact that my home went up by 30% and they want to sell. But obviously their next thought is, but where am I going to live? Now I have to buy a place, and all of them have gone up by a significant amount. So it kind of wipes out your gain if you do both.
Yeah. And so I think this forbearance story is interesting to see how this kind of plays out. I think the fact that we've seen this go down from 7.2 to 1.5 million and kind of have been able to see what that's done to the market, and the fact that we still are so strong, I think everything points to we can easily weather this. It just might mean a little more supply in the fall.
But so I think during your research and during your interviews with industry professionals, I think folks are calling it more of a rebalancing effect than a crisis.
That's right. Rebalancing. Yeah. I like to use the word like a supply shock, the supply shock. I know that sometimes somebody might read that and get scared maybe, but I mean that because we're seeing a lot of the dynamics change in the economy and some of them flipping back. And we're seeing that happening in the supply chain right now. And then also as some of the stimulus leaves the economy. But you're right. That supply shock should just help to rebalance the market, which has been really out of whack during COVID with such a, so low supply.
The word shock has kind of a negative connotation, but in this case, it's a good thing to kind of balance things out a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's really interesting. And I mean, I feel like that's really, really hits the nail on the head as to what might be coming down the pipe. But like you said, nobody really knows 100% what's going to happen or what percentage of those folks are going to be in a situation where they'll list their property back on the market. And if it does end up being, closer to 50%, that would definitely have a bigger effect than we're talking about now. Yeah.
Yeah. And one of the other things is, so supply is just so tight still, and and they can't ramp that up easily. And even if they wanted to, material costs and the supply chain wouldn't allow it anyway. But you look at how lopsided it is between supply and demand. There is just so many potential home buyers still coming into the market these next few years. I point this out in my articles a lot, but the millennial generation aggregate is a large generation. But when you splice it up, the beginning half of it is not that big. It's really the birth rates was pretty similar to the Gen Xers. And it wasn't until the end of the 80s when I don't know why, but just a lot of babies were getting plopped out. And so the five biggest birth years, 1989, 1990, 1991, 1992, 1993. And so in 2019, we entered into the five-year period where they're all going to hit 30 between 2019 and 2023. So that side of it is still there. And even if, you know, you do see these shocks, there's just so much, so many buyers still coming into the market over the next few years and supply still being so tight, not there to meet it.
Mm-hmm. That's really interesting because I remember reading articles a few years ago, how all of those people saw their parents getting burned during 2008, 2009, 2010. And they were very cautious of getting into the housing market. And there ended up being a lot more renters because of that, as folks didn't want to get their money tied into a house. And then after all of that, we see this absolute craziness that's happening now, which my wife and I were actually in the process of buying a house as well. And the one that we ended up getting under contract had five people bidding on it, and all of the bids were above asking price significantly. So that was very interesting to see that dynamic, to go from extreme caution and just renting to being willing to pay whatever it takes for a house.
Yeah. Yeah, it's been wild. And, yeah. And so are there any other questions for me, or do you want to know anything about media? I'm an open book.
Yeah, it's very interesting to me. So you said about the newsletter, you're talking about general trends, not just about real estate.
Yeah, so I rarely look at real estate in the newsletter. You know, last week was kind of looking at the supply chain. So going out, looking at different prices, how those have changed. I do a lot of CEO surveys to see where they stand on different positions, where they kind of see their revenue, their profit going. You know, and then sometimes I'll do like questions going to CEOs. Where do you think we're heading in terms of work from home? And then I'll ask managers, and then I'll ask just regular workers. And it's been interesting to see that although, you know, the top bosses in America are pretty open to a hybrid workplace, they really would like it 3 to 4 days in the office. But then as you kind of work down each level and you get to the workers, a lot of them really would like 1 to 2.
They don't want to be in the office. And that part definitely did affect, that was one of the driving forces in the housing explosion that we saw, that people are able to work from home at more companies. And that was driving them to move and to move out of the cities and into suburbs and seek housing there.
Yeah. And that's actually exactly what I did. You know, I lived the past 5 years up until COVID hit, my wife and I, in New York City. And we had known we were going to move back to Ohio at some point. You know, we had a daughter and it wasn't the best place to, you know, raise a family in the city. And we both had family in Ohio. So it's very early on in COVID, I realized this was going to be my chance to take the job remote. So we built a home last summer and then moved in December.
Okay. And you were able to completely go remote with everything.
Yes. Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah. That's how I got into the whole lumber coverage, is I, you know, I got it right before it started to really take off. And it was, you know, and the builders were starting to get a little uneasy about it because they kind of saw things starting to happen last summer.
That's amazing. And so with the lumber coverage, I mean, I guess now the prices have gone back down to where they were prior to the jump. Is that right?
Yeah. So wholesale prices of lumber are pretty much back to pre-COVID levels, although they're starting to move up a little bit right now. And really what that is just the pent-up demand on the do-it-yourself side. That's really what fell off of the market this summer, is so many of the, you know, do-it-yourselfers didn't want to, you know, pay that price tag. But then there's that economic psychology that each week seeing prices fall and reading that prices were falling, they didn't want to go out and do the project either because they knew in a few weeks they'd probably get a better price. And so those people, now that they've kind of seen things level out, are going back into the market. But still, the economic factors that gave us that, you know, 300% lumber, those are gone. Those shocks have worked through the system, especially on the supply side. But it is moving up right now, and it should continue to move up into the fall.
Well, good for everybody. I know there's definitely some homeowners who started building a home right before the hikes went up, and there's some builders who were not making money at all finishing those homes. So those people locked out, but for a lot, it's been really tough. So I'm glad that they're coming down. In the meantime, while they think about that, I wanted to ask you. So Fortune magazine, obviously there's a printed version. Things are going more and more online. Where do you see that going eventually? Print's been really hard, I hear.
Yeah. So we are down to 6 issues per year, but the company is actually growing, especially on the digital side, pretty fast since we had new ownership take over the publication, and we've expanded out and built a few more digital media businesses on top of it. But print is going where you would kind of expect print to go. We are in a digital world, but it'll be interesting to see how things play out in the digital world too. Early on, it looked like the BuzzFeeds and the Vices were really just going to kick everybody's butt. But as things went on, some of the what you would call more legacy publications, Wall Street Journal, New York Times, finally got it together and figured out how to win there and really build those premium audiences that Vice and BuzzFeed just couldn't.
That's really amazing. I've always been fascinated with that and journalism in general. So that's really, really amazing to hear. I would imagine now with 6 issues per year, it becomes a lot more important what's on the cover.
Yeah, that's right. And we had one that was NFT recently, our most recent issue. And we partnered with this really well-known artist in the NFT space, and they ended up selling for like $1 million total. So that was kind of interesting. But yeah, with only 6 covers, you have to be smart and strategic with them.
Again, Lance, thank you for coming to the call. Really great having you. We're going to post this call on our website at club500.us. We're also going to post it on YouTube and our Facebook page. So a lot of our members are going to get to see it and get a lot of value out of it. So thank you, Lance. Great having you on, and hope to see you again in the future.
Yeah, this was awesome. And real quick before I go, if you ever have any story ideas or you see a piece and you think I missed something or should have added something, feel free to email me at lance.lambert@fortune.com or on Twitter at @newslambert. And, I love to hear from people in the real estate industry. I really think of especially the people on the ground in regional markets is almost like regional economists. Those markets so well, and you see them change faster than the data can come out. So I'd love to hear from folks if you have any story ideas.
That's a really great point. I always say that there's 400 MSAs in the US, 400 metropolitan statistical areas that are basically 400 markets, I guess. And so it's very interesting to hear that. And I typically ask for contact information at the end, just didn't know if you wanted that to happen. So thank you for sharing that. And to our members, yes, if you have something, definitely reach out. And thank you guys. See you guys next time.